Okay, so last time we talked about preload and afterload. Today we're going to talk about how those two play into the entire kind of hemodynamic system, and then things that we can do to affect preload and afterload, whether it's elevated or low. So before we get started though, remember we talked preload is a volume, afterload is a pressure. So a little mnemonic you can use to remember that is PVAP. Preload volume, afterload pressure. Okay, and as we talk through this, that will become kind of clear what that mnemonic means, and then understanding that mnemonic is going to help you determine how you can correct problems in your patient. Okay, so first of all, this little chart here basically covers the hemodynamics and what you need to know about different elements of hemodynamics. First of all, we have our heart rate. Okay, our heart rate, and this is our little heart here, atria, ventricles, aorta, tricuspid, pulmonic valve, mitral valve, aortic valve. Okay, so atria on top, ventricles on bottom, here's our little valves. Okay, so heart rate originates up here in the atria, in the sinoatrial node, we know. So heart rate should normally be between 60 and 80. Okay, and there's a couple things that can cause that to increase, to be higher than it should or lower than it should. What our heart rate is going to directly affect our cardiac output. Okay, now these things kind of, they work with each other, so it's not like one necessarily causes the other, but it works reverse-wise as well. So stroke volume is going to be affected by afterload and vice versa. So heart rate is going to affect cardiac output. And so our cardiac output is the volume of blood that leaves the heart per minute. Okay, so what's leaving this left ventricle every minute? Normal should be 4 to 8 liters per minute. Now, what they found throughout the years was that that number varies based on the patient's size. So a petite little old grandma isn't going to need as high of a cardiac output as a much smaller individual. Okay, so what they did is they decided to start multiplying that by body surface area. So they take cardiac output, multiply it by body surface area, and what you come up with is a cardiac index, and the normal for that should be about 2.5 to 4 liters per minute per meter squared. Okay, so this is kind of more the number we're going to use, what's our cardiac index, because that's going to, cardiac output's going to vary based on the patient's size. Okay, now cardiac output is going to be affected by stroke volume. We talked a bit about stroke volume in the last video, but stroke volume is basically the volume of blood per beat. Okay, cardiac output is per minute, and stroke volume is per beat. Okay, now the way we calculate stroke volume is we get end diastolic volume minus end systolic volume. So we take what is left in the ventricles after systole, and we subtract that by what is in the ventricles at the end of diastole. At the end of filling, what's there minus what's there after contraction. Okay, so normal for that would be 60 to 120 mils per beat. And then what we talked about in the last video is preload, contractility, and afterload. Okay, so these are the three things that directly affect our stroke volume, or the amount of blood that's leaving our heart every minute, or every beat, I'm sorry. So the three things that are going to affect that are going to be contractility first, which is the squeeze of the ventricles, and then preload, which we talked about, is the volume, and then afterload, which is the pressure that the ventricles must squeeze against in order to push blood out through the aorta. Okay? So with preload, let's talk about preload really quick. We talked about preload is a volume. It's really basically your end diastolic volume, which means the volume of blood in the ventricles at the end of diastole, the end of filling, the volume that's in there. Okay? And there's two ways to measure that number. The two ways to measure that number are going to be CVP and pulmonary artery occlusive pressure. CVP is relatively easy to measure. You can actually even measure that through a central line. You place the central line, the tip of that sits close to, so it kind of sits right in here. And with that, we can actually kind of get a measure of the central venous pressure. Okay, obviously we're talking about our central veins here, and that's gonna kind of give us our central venous pressure. And the number we're gonna get for that, the number we're aiming for with that is 2 to 6, okay? So central venous pressure is basically gonna tell us our preload. That's gonna tell us how much blood is kind of returning to the heart and what's gonna be available to fill the ventricles. Okay, so that's CVP. You also have pulmonary artery occlusive pressure. That's a little bit harder to measure because what we do is we get a reading in our pulmonary artery. So we feed a line down like this and up like this. And we get a reading in our, and then they can actually fill up a little balloon right here. And what that'll do is it'll give them a reading of the right atria. And with that right atria, they can kind of estimate pulmonary artery occlusive pressure, which gives them an estimate on the preload of the left ventricle. So that's done through a much more complicated catheter. And generally, you're not gonna have every ICU patient's gonna have that. But most ICU patients are gonna have a central line. So it becomes very easy to just measure off of our CVP rather than our pulmonary wedge pressure. So PAOP, occlusive pressure, or wedge pressure, it means the same thing, okay? So really the number we're gonna look at is CVP, and what that's gonna tell us is that's gonna tell us our number for our preload. Preload, again, is the volume. So preload is the volume in our ventricle at the end of diastole. At the end of filling, is that volume in there, okay? Next, we have our afterload, okay? Our afterload, like I said, is the pressure required to open these valves, your aortic valve and your pulmonic valve, and to get the blood out of the ventricles. That can be measured with two numbers, peripheral vascular resistance or pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance. So SVR is really the number we're gonna use for that. So systemic vascular resistance is the resistance in your systemic vasculature that the ventricles have to squeeze against to get blood into the aorta, okay? So systemic vascular resistance, that's 800 to 1400, and the number is dynes per something, I don't remember, but 800 to 1400, 800 to 1200 basically is the number we're looking at for that, okay? So that's our afterload, it's the pressure required to open that valve and get blood out of the heart. Okay, so let's look really quick back at preload. So preload, like we talked about, is a volume. So there's your preload can be elevated, okay? And so what that's basically saying is that we have too much volume, okay? And so if we look at the cures for that, or the things that doctors might request to lower preload, it's things like venous vasodilators, right? Volume coming in. So venous vasodilators like nitrates, diuretics, ACE inhibitors, and ARBs. So those are all things that are going to try to decrease. So if our preload's elevated, we're gonna try to decrease volume basically. Okay? If our preload is decreased, if our volume coming in is low, then what we can do is we can give things like fluid and blood. So if it's low, we're gonna try to increase volume. Okay? And then if we look over here at okay, so now let's talk afterload again. Remember, afterload is the pressure. It's the pressure required of these ventricles in order to push blood out into the aorta. So it's how much pressure we're working against in our vessels to try to get blood out of there. Okay, so if our afterload is low, okay, so if we need to tighten up these vessels, if we need to increase the pressure required to get it out, we're gonna give things like vasopressors. Okay, so we'll give things like norepinephrine, neosinephrine, vasopressin, or epinephrine. The thing we use most often on my neurological floor is neosinephrine. And usually you'll give them in a specific order based on the condition of the patient. But basically, if in situations like shock, sepsis, things like that, we need to increase that pressure. Our vessels have dilated dramatically and we need to get a little bit more squeeze on there, so we'll give things like vasopressors for that. And that's gonna bring our systemic vascular resistance, it's gonna squeeze those, and we're gonna tighten that up, make it harder to open this, the aortic valve here, and require the ventricles to squeeze a little bit harder to get through there. Now, if we need to, or if our afterload is too high, if it's too hard for these, for this to open up, if the ventricles are having to work too hard to get blood into the aorta, we're gonna get things like arterial vasodilators, right? So we're gonna dilate our vessels, dilate our arteries specifically with things like hydralazine to try to open that up a little bit easier for blood to get out and to get into the system and to perfuse the body. So we can get things like arterial vasodilators, ACE inhibitors, ARBs, and we can use things like intra-aortic balloon pumps, which is a little balloon fed up here. And during systole, this is gonna